Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Project C. I am your host, Cina Ghiassi. Today I've got my coach, Habby Heske, in the house, and Jack's back from Japan as well, so we thought we'd talk about his MMA bout over there, which he did win. Say hello to the camera, guys.
Hey, guys.
Project C.
Project C. Habby Heske, you're actually one of the first names I put down when I was putting down ideas of people I'd like to sit down and do a podcast with. You're actually one of the originals on the list, so I'm very thankful you could come down.
The original and the last.
Yeah. Pardon?
Thanks, that's good.
Yeah. Now, because you're someone that you're probably actually one of the first people that probably introduced me to the MMA scene, in the sense of when I first came down to Mac 1, I just came down. You were right next to Zest, if you remember, on Scarborough Beach Road. And back then, I just hit the gym a little bit in terms of weights, keeping fit, went down, had a look, jiu-jitsu, what's this all about, you know? Mm. And you popped the gi on me, it was like pajamas, it was hanging off, but you're like, nah, it's going to shrink and stuff, but got into it and then just fell in love, you know? And then from there, just started educating myself about the sport and everything like that, so. And you especially got stories for days. I mean, you're one of the pioneers really in Perth of MMA. One of the first guys to really bring jiu-jitsu to Perth, teach it. So there's so many things we can talk about with you. I don't even know where to start. A movie career as well. Where would you like to kick things off?
Well, started jiu-jitsu in 91. Yeah. There was a Blitz magazine out, and John Will had a Blitz magazine out, and there was an article with the Gracie brothers and say they can, you know, they'll fight anyone, anytime. And it was interesting, because virtually all we had was kickboxing, boxing, karate. You know, you had Aikido and stuff like that, judo. But really, like the no rules, you didn't really hear much about that. Mm. Cool, it was either a street fight or, you know, other than that. So, but the there was an article. And that's when the Blitz magazines were black and white then. Mm. So I read through it. I just won the Australian title in heavyweight kickboxing in 91. And I've always enjoyed traveling. I traveled, you know, from a young age to Thailand to train in late 1989. Did Thai boxing, trained there, you know, like 3 months at a time. It was pretty fun. And then had a fair few professional fights and amateur fights beforehand. And then I originally come from judo. I started judo when I was 10 years old.
That was the first martial arts
I was 10 years old. My father would have put me in judo, and I was the first day I remember, you know, putting on the kimono there and getting thrown around and just crying and not really enjoying it, but eventually stuck at it. And I did it till I was 13, till we moved to Australia.
And you were living in Canada,
was it? Canada. So I did judo for 3 years. So I had, you know, had a bit of, still had a bit of knowledge of the basic sort of, you know, Ippon throws and stuff like that and basic break falls. But then, in 91, I thought, oh, this looks awesome. So then I actually went to the States and found Hicks and Gracie. There was maybe 6 to 8 people in a class, and then maybe a couple of white belts. Some blues, purples, maybe a brown, and then Hickson. And then I trained there for 3 months, and then he was going to Hawaii, and then he says he's going to do a seminar in Hawaii and with his brother called Helson Gracie. So I said, I wouldn't mind tagging along. So I went over there and spent a weekend with him over there. And they're really hospitality. You know, it was nice. It was good. And then just backwards and forwards for a few years, just kept going backwards and forwards to the States and learning, and then had a bit of a break, come back. Had the first pancreas fight in Australia, and that was in 93. Yeah. And I fought a judo fighter from New Zealand. Yeah. And that was fun. The rules were a bit all out of whack, but didn't have gloves, but you could open slap and kick and punch. And then I think I had to submit him 3 times to win the bout. It was a bit all over
what?
Shot. Yeah. You could touch
them,
right? Yeah. So it was a bit different. But it was big. It was big. And it's sort of like, then they started doing a bit more MMA. And that's before the UFC I think the UFC started in 94, I think.
Yeah, early 90s, yeah. About that.
But before the UFC, they had Japan, Belchudo.
Yeah, bare knuckles.
Yeah. And that's where Hickson went over and fought in Japan, and that's when it started to get really big.
Yeah.
And so, that started to get really big in 94. But before that, they still had a lot of Belchudo back in Brazil.
Yeah.
It was big in Brazil. And then... and then the UFC eventuated from there, and that.
You came out at quite a unique time where MMA was kind of born, in the sense.
Yeah.
Where you were probably growing up, a lot of martial arts in the sense of judo, karate, boxing, what works, what doesn't work. I mean, you heard of a lot of these kind of bullshit stories, I'm sure, growing up. You know, energy throws and blocking, stuff like that. I mean, what was it with your father originally that got you into judo? Was it just something he did originally? Or was there some form of bullying involved?
I don't think so. My father was actually a weightlifter.
Yeah.
You know, more of a bodybuilder than that. So I think he just put me into it, you know, just to get me busy.
Yeah.
But ever since then, you know, like, you know, did judo for 3 years. We moved from Vancouver, Canada to Australia, to Perth. And then I boxed at Police and Citizens Club.
Yeah.
And then I trained karate, was in Dukai, and then had a bunch of amateur kickboxing fights.
Yeah.
Where PKA was kicking, he had a kick above the waist. Okay. So, yeah, it's like the old karate, you know, the old full contact karate.
Yeah.
He had the boxing gloves, and then what you had to do is you had to get 8 kicks in each round. You know, to score points, you know, before.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you'd lose points. So everyone would sort of do the quick 8 kicks and then just throw leather, you know. So, yeah. You know, that was the old. And then in the mid 80s, when 1986, my coach Rod Stroud and Bob Jones went over to Thailand and Amsterdam, and then found out, you know, the Dutch Thai boxing and the kickboxing, and, you know, the Thai boxing. And that's when they bring it back and they amalgamated it into all the kickboxing and the karate. And that's when the Muay Thai come to Australia. So it sort of hit like late 80s.
Yeah.
And then everyone got away from the PKA, which was kicking above the waist, to sort of kicking leg kicks as well. And that's like the old, remember Don Wilson?
No.
Don the Dragon Wilson and Dino... You know, yeah, it was a couple of the old
Dutch kickboxers.
Yeah, they were American, but then
Dutch style.
No, they were more the karate style.
Okay.
Bill Superfoot Wallace, Chuck Norris. That was all, you know, the full contact karate.
Yeah.
And then Benny the Jet Akitas. Yeah. You ever heard of him? No.
No.
Ever heard of him? Boy, I'm showing my age, I think.
Yeah, it's a photo in the gym.
Yeah, Pete Sugarfoot Cunningham, all those guys. And then eventually kickboxing coming big, especially because the kickboxer with Van Damme in the late 80s come out, and that's when the world really got exposed to Thai boxing.
It's funny how that works in terms of these movies back then really showed the world. You know, the kickboxer was huge. I mean, even the movie you did with The Quest, which was really kind of a way similar to a UFC in a style of different fighters from around the world, you know, their unique styles of fighting come together. What the hell was a Mongolian's technique, though? I don't even know the guy who actually won it.
Mongolian guy was actually, he's in a few movies with Van Damme.
Is he? Yeah.
He's in the movie where he's got the little cat as well. He's got the big sideburns, comes out of the, I don't know what it was called, but they're childhood friends.
Okay.
Because that big guy, Mongolian, his brother is actually the kickboxer, Tong Po. In the kickboxer.
Okay. The monster.
Yeah. So they've always have roles. On the set of the kickboxer, most Van Damme's movies, a lot of them are childhood friends that train.
Okay, he kind of carries that same circle of friends around with him.
Well, you'll see the guys, different characters,
but
the same guys. So.
What was he like in terms of, because did he help direct the movie? I mean...
The director, I think it was a British guy.
He's iconic too. I mean, anyone growing up in terms of like those martial arts movies. I mean, Stallone and Arnold were meatheads, but they weren't doing the martial arts in a sense.
Yeah.
Van Damme was kicking ass and fucking Well, that's a swear jar. That's the first one. For people who don't know, Habby's brought along a little swear jar. What are the costs, by the way, for each?
Oh, whatever you put it in.
Whatever you put in, all right. So
should that's be gold coin.
Gold coin, damn. We'll, you know what, we'll donate it to Jack and Marco's
yeah, it's fine.
American world tour.
We'll be on to swear.
We've got about, that should be time for about $2 by the time we go.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, so the MMA sort of originated sort of like back in, you know, the mid-90s.
Yeah.
And it was good because you've seen different styles of martial arts, like kickboxers, wrestlers, judoka players, just even street fighters or pit fighters, what they call them.
Just pure aggression coming at you, yeah.
So to see it evolve now is, you know, it's just like
insane, you know, eh?
Yeah, it's crazy.
To where it's gotten to. I mean, it's a $4 billion company now, the UFC. I mean, did you ever foresee that? I mean, in the space of really 20 years where the sport's grown so radically.
It was hard. I didn't know. I didn't know whether sort of, you know, about, you know, legalization of it, because it was all in. Then it was, Japan was fine. Mm-hmm. Japan was fine. But in America, all the previous, you know, start of the UFCs were in Indian reservations.
Yeah.
So you couldn't have them out anywhere. So it was it was all in the casinos,
yeah,
on Indian land. So it wasn't regulated. But since the athletic board got onto it, you know,
kind of cleaned it up, brought in the gloves. Yeah.
There was no gloves before. There was no time limits. There was no weight divisions.
Oh, they didn't even have the time limits originally.
I mean, even one fighter had one boxing glove on, and it was just like.
Well, that was the first guy who fought.
I remember the Hoist. Sumo versus Royce Gracie. That was funny.
It was a sumo versus the who was it? He was a kickboxer. No, he was a.
Royce Gracie wore a gi against him, didn't he?
No, the sumo fought another guy, and he just got kicked in the face, and his tooth just flew out of the ring.
The sumo in the Quest has actually fought on the UFC as well.
Oh, has he?
Yeah, in the earlier.
He was a proper sumo, like full on.
But yeah, so it was good to see it evolve to what it is now. But like in what you're saying before, when you first come to the gym, like, you know, seeing the MMA, and then back then, you know, we started learning jiu-jitsu. Had the basics of boxing, kickboxing, wrestling, learning wrestling from America, you know, like American coaches and stuff like that. It's hard in Australia because wrestling isn't, you know, in your curriculum at school.
Yeah,
you know? Whereas in America and Canada, you know, it is. So you're growing up with wrestling, but when you talk to people in Australia, it's just like they're really not interested.
Yeah.
Well, then, you know, ground fighting was really non-existent.
Yeah.
So it was. You know, and that's why, again, the first UFCs are a lot of wrestlers coming into it.
Mm.
You know, so it was different because you've seen different, you know, different stages. Like first the jiu-jitsu guys would win, you know, and then it was the wrestlers, you know, the ground and pound, like, yeah, Mark Kerr and all them, Mark Coleman, and the kickboxers come in. It was Maurice Smith, and then, you know, a few other, you know, Pat Smith. There was a few other guys, and then it changed back to, you know, sort of like, you know, more, you know, the jiu-jitsu guys, yeah, and then just, you know, now it's come just like athletes that have trained in everything, you know, because then you didn't do the whole lot. You either boxed, kickboxed, jiu-jitsu, yeah, MMA. It wasn't really, you know,
that was your niche. That
the
was
Bell like, Chido, yeah, fighters from Brazil weren't specialists on standing up.
Yeah,
you know, like you see a lot of the old karate, the old Gracie style of sort of stamping the foot, keeping the hands down, chin up.
Yeah.
You know, now it's totally evolved. It's changed, you know. Now, and it's good because you see, you know, like years ago, you train guys, we'd have to do boxing over there, we'd have to kickboxing over here, we'd do jiu-jitsu over there, wrestling over there, and amalgamate it all together.
Yeah.
And it would take, you know, it took me a lifetime just about, where we got now.
To boys, collect it all together.
Yeah, yeah. You know, yeah, and sort of put it all together, you know. Now you've got guys coming to the gym, you know, they train a year, 2 years, 3 years, you know, phenoms, because they just learn everything, all the basics that they need to know, yeah, and they know how to punch, kick, footwork, shoot, sprawl, submit, yeah, you know, they got it all, you know, so.
It's weird, you actually watch street fights now, and you can tell guys don't have maybe a blue belt or whatever, mm-hmm, but they understand the common knowledge of, you know, sprawling and, you know, defense, and, mm-hmm, it's quite interesting to see the public have really evolved as well in the way they view the sport. Does that make sense?
Where do you see the street fights?
I've never seen the street fights.
Are they allowed a tap? Oh, fair enough.
These on YouTube,
I've seen a few tab outs.
On YouTube, all the time, I'm just typing in street fights and just seeing like jiu-jitsu and street fight or like something like that and seeing like what people use and just seeing... It's insane. Majority of them happen in Russia, funny enough. The Russians just get bored and just say, fuck it, let's just... second swear one. They just love fighting. I don't know if they're bored out there, but it is really interesting, the involvement of the sport and the integration of every martial arts. Do you think there is one martial arts in terms of a base you should come from? Or do you think in terms of the best outcome or just an involvement of everything together, progression?
I really think the best martial arts or, you know, fighting styles are the amateur styles. Like you got the amateur boxing. They'll show you, I mean, when you watch amateur boxers fight, their footwork, you know, is great. You know, basic punching, slipping, dipping, rolling. Then you have the wrestling. You know, you got the good wrestling, you know, and then judo.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, for my boys, I think, you know, like, it's, you know, if you had basic wrestling, boxing, and judo, you know, and then learn the submissions after, then you have a good foundation, you know, because again, we have a lot of people come into the gym, I want to do MMA, you know, and they go, well, have you done anything before? No, but I've watched 105 UFCs, you know, and their feet are crossed, you know, their hands are upside down, they're looking the wrong way, and it's like, what do we do? You know, it's like, well, I think first of all, maybe you start a bit of boxing, do jiu-jitsu or some, you know, some basic, you know, basic judo to start off and sort of get you on the... Everyone wants to be a fighter, you know, but it's... Again, it's like you need to learn from the ground up, you know, learn the foundation. It's like building a house. You know, you can't build a house if you haven't got a good foundation because everything's just going to go out of whack.
I'm sure you've seen over the years as well, especially being a gym owner, so many guys have just walked in and been like, you know, I want to do this, I want to do that. And then you see it, that they're not capable of, you know, MMA just yet, you know, but probably that works against them in terms of they probably don't, you can probably foresee their personality in terms of their patience. And you really got to be patient to develop as a martial artist to, you know, to get your black belts and stuff like that. It takes years, you know.
The best fighters I've had come through the gym are the guys that have come to the gym to just train, have fun, learn something, and then eventually progress through that.
Yeah.
Everyone I've come into the gym and say, I want to be a fighter and like that, they last for maybe 3 months.
Is that what Jackie did?
No, just like they last for a few months and then you don't see them.
Yeah.
It's the guys who've never really asked for anything and like, or never said anything, been really, you know, quiet and, you know, unassuming, and you know, they're the ones that will turn into world champions.
That is quite interesting though, if you think about it. The quite reserved ones are the ones who actually end up becoming the killers, you know,
Well, they're not rushing it. I don't think it's like when someone comes in, oh, I want to be a fighter, or so this or that. But I've had guys come in that want to do some boxing and seeing jiu-jitsu or vice versa, and then, you know, come good at it, you know, really excelled in it, you know, been doing something that they didn't even think of doing at the start, you know. So I think it's a lot of the people are hyped up when they see something, you know, and then they think, I want to do it, and then they realize how hard it is, you know, all the basic training. Oh, it's training,
insanely hard.
You know, it's same. It's like we have a lot of people that want to do no-gi submission wrestling before they do jiu-jitsu, and most academies won't even let you do no-gi until you're blue belt or three stripes or you've done 6 months or a year of jiu-jitsu. Because it's a faster paced no-gi.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's...
You got to understand the basics.
And because they're so... 100 miles that, you know, I'm trying to, you know, scramble and doing something like that, and they lose a lot of the basic, you know, fundamentals of everything. So I think it's really, you know, that's why we get people coming into the gym and go, I want to be a fighter, do this and that. And they realize, hang on, you got to learn how to stand. You got to learn how to break fall.
Yeah.
You know, you got to learn the basics. And they go, oh, I want to fight. You know, so maybe somewhere else. Back. Yeah. And it's usually the case of, everyone that, you know, I've had people leave, we got rid of the answering machine, that leave 30 minute messages that just run it out, you know, like I've done karate, kung fu, and I've had two fights, two wins, and you know, no one's going to fight me on the street anymore. And I've had, it's like, or 1,000 fights, and I'm going, well, we're closed.
You should have kept those answering machines. What did you end up doing, Jack, in the beginning in terms of like coming down to Mac 1? Was that the first gym you trained at, or?
No, I trained at the first one that it was Gracie Baja when I started.
Yeah.
I just started doing jiu-jitsu. I started doing the MMA, but it was the first thing they said to me is do jiu-jitsu with a gi.
Yeah.
So I kept doing that. Kept doing the MMA, and I pretty much just went between the MMA classes that they had. And then I like the jiu-jitsu with the gi as well, so I did that a lot, and then just mix it up between kickboxing classes, jiu-jitsu, and then they kind of put it together with the MMA.
Yeah.
But so I joined there, then they changed names, but they were more about jiu-jitsu.
Originally?
Yeah, they had a few guys that were doing MMA and stuff, but the head coach just wasn't really about MMA, so.
Yeah. Is that frustrating to see, in terms of... Well, it's probably not frustrating for you because it doesn't really affect you in some way, but a lot of certain martial artists or teachers, whatever, gym owners, they're very stuck in their ways. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Of this is what I do. This is what works. The rest is just nonsense,
Mm-hmm.
And they can't really evolve in a sense of learning because obviously yourself, you've done the stand-up, you've done the groundwork, you've done everything, but what is it about certain gyms that just want to stick to that one element? That they don't want to branch out, or they don't even believe it. They just go, it's all nonsense, Is it just the fear within themselves or not knowing the knowledge,
Yeah, it's there's years ago, there was just now you see gyms, they have kickboxing, boxing, wrestling, yoga, judo. So, there's definitely more to offer nowadays because before there is either jiu-jitsu, boxing, kickboxing, and people would amalgamate them all together. They'd just be like one or the other. But now, as business, people want to do different things, So now you'll see that the old Thai boxing gyms used just Thai boxing. Now they're doing BJJ or mixed martial arts or something like that. So I think it was the fear of not knowing, keeping your eyes shut and going, no, that's it. This is the best art.
It's safer.
And especially traditional arts are a bit like that, like Taekwondo or karate or, but sometimes you just got to think outside the box, to learn different things, For me, it's been great to be able to be a bit diverse in all the different styles because everything's got something to offer, even karate, kung fu.
Yeah.
I did some kung fu when I moved up to Darwin when I was 17.
Yeah.
It was totally different stance and line and stuff like that, but just... Yeah, it was good fun. It was different. Opened my eyes to a few different things, and then...
Well, you see, there's a few guys in UFC actually who come from a kung fu base.
Yeah, I think the Jason...
they've got great kicks.
Yeah, there was a guy in the earlier UFCs, Jason DeLuca or something, there were a couple of good guys, that were really good, So, it's just, it's great now to see a whole bunch of gyms have different, different styles to offer, and that's, you'll pick one, you like one, and it gives you a bit of diversity and everything, so you're not just stuck the same. But again, I think, in your growing, in your sort of basic, for a child, or teenagers, I think it's good to just keep with one for time being, mm-hmm. Either like judo, boxing, or
wrestling,
like I said, back to the amateur, I totally firmly believe teaching BJJ to kids, but I think judo or wrestling is better for kids at the start, and then when they're in their adolescent years or a little bit older, then learning basic, a bit more about jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
I have two martial arts schools where we're teaching kids jiu-jitsu, but I think really, when you start in kids... either some gymnastics. It comes back to all the Olympic sports, really. Gymnastics, judo. And then you have, if you have a young boy that's done judo for 5-6 years and comes and does jiu-jitsu, he's good, He's got all the basic, he's got the basic fundamentals of, posture and then just once he starts learning a bit more submissions and have the fluent, you know, the fluent movement of BJJ, then they're tough, you know.
The sport itself, you've kept this up your whole life from a very young age. What was it in terms of motivation that just carried you through? I mean, from a young age, did you say, you said like you started judo, but you didn't initially enjoy it. But what was the motivation of saying, you know what, I want to keep this up. I want to become a champion. Or did it just keep progressing to the point you did it for years, became Muay Thai champion, and then, you know.
Yeah, I just enjoyed it, and it became a lifestyle for me. So it wasn't, you know, it wasn't a hobby. It was, you know, sort of lived and breathed it, and I've been doing it really since I was 10 years old.
Yeah.
You know, it's not, you know, I've had a couple of days off here and there.
Yeah.
But yeah.
But you're always training. I mean, I'm sometimes driving down Sky Ridge Road and I see you doing like your 5K runs down. But it's amazing to see someone, especially your age, you're in your later 40s, but you're still in amazing shape, you know?
Mm-hmm. Can we edit the 40s?
It's at 29.
It's been an
awesome. It's a compliment, you know? It honestly is, you know?
It's been an awesome road, you know? And I hope I've got a fair few more years, you know? So I've just come back to competition now, so I haven't competed since. Well, I pro boxed last time in 2007, but just for some fun. And then I've started back, you know, competing in jiu-jitsu. It's been awesome. You know, it's like I had a 12-year gap.
Yeah.
So, and it's good. I enjoy training because I'm training with the guys as well, and I'm really enjoying it. And I'm sort of over most of my injuries. You know, touch wood. So.
What do you have going on with the body right now?
I'm pretty good at the moment. You know, I just have a couple of niggle injuries, but I had some serious injuries at once. So I broke my back. You've got my bicep off.
Torn bicep, I remember you telling me that.
You know, I've had two balls discs in my neck.
Ouch. You're not going to get like titanium on your
neck. I've had a few things, you know, that sort of stopped me. And, you know, but it's been good now, you know, so like I'm on track. I'm enjoying it. We've got a, you know, real good competition. You know, we've got a good competition team, I think. You know, we're great. You know, some world champions there. You know, some up and coming guys in all various, you know, styles.
Yeah.
And it's just good to be amongst them. And I'm always away, you know, when they're fighting and competition. And it's just, you know, it's good to jump in there and have some fun. And I think it's good for them to see me have a bit of fun as well. And
Do you think the wear and tear is always going to be part of the athlete in terms of even if you try to recover, ice baths, your yoga, whatever it is, it's just the years are going to catch up to you, really.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, jiu-jitsu is good because you can move around that, because, you know, it depends, you know, with your training partners and that. But you'll see a lot of like the Olympic sports, like usually when they're in the after the 30s, and you don't really see many people boxing when they're 40 or, you know, 50 or, you know, or judo, you know, judo is a hard sport, you know, it's a very impact sport, so you don't see many judo clubs playing judo when they're 30 or 40. They usually do it from maybe 19 to 25, and that's it, you know.
Yeah.
So, and same with wrestling, collegiate wrestling, because they do it for such a young age at school and high school.
By the time they're
18, 19, 20 years old, they've had enough.
I've always heard, like, from people who compete in a lot of mixed martial arts, they always say wrestling's by far the hardest.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely on your body.
So yeah. Draining and taxing as well. You're just exhausted. Yeah. A lot of weight cuts evolved in wrestling as well, even from a junior level.
Real big.
Yeah.
So the UFC has complimented most of the wrestlers now, because the wrestlers, when they leave, you know, collegiate wrestling or Olympic wrestling, then you'll see them sort of venture into MMA, you know. So, but yeah, it's...
They tend to have just an amazing mindset as well in terms of that grind of pushing through. You know, you got guys like Daniel Cormier and stuff, Olympic wrestlers and stuff, just insane. Yeah. But then it's crazy, you see like a guy like John Jones who doesn't have as much as a wrestling experience do so well against them, you know?
Yeah.
But he's got that pure martial arts experience.
But every athlete, I mean, from athletes, from even runners or, you know, athletics... You know, you're always going to have a pulled hamstring or something. You know, there's always something. It's natural. It's like football players. You know, I don't think you're going to have a football career without an injury.
Yeah.
Either a knee op or something like that. I think it's just the way of, you know, when you're involved in professional or even amateur or professional sports, there is going to be some sort of, you know, there's going to be some sort of injury that you'll have or come across in your career. It's just,
you know, part of it, really. Well, you're always pushing your body to the extreme. Yeah. You're never just training at 50%. You're always pushing it at 100, and then the niggles, they'll come or they won't, you know. But
it's good now too, because you know, with sports science, like years ago, like, you know, kickboxing, we just run 10Ks, we'd spar 10 rounds and hit 10 round of pads and just do that. So be brain dead.
How many times a week would they get you doing that?
Well, you do the sparring on the opposite day of pad work, and then you do the runs and the sprints on the other days. But now, you know, there's a lot of sports specific training, you know, so now you wouldn't, you know, have to run 10Ks, you know, you maybe run short distance with a bit more CrossFit or, you know, cross training. You won't spar so many rounds, not as hard. We used to spar.
We used to spar
really hard in those days, really? You know, it's like, you know, the fight was the easy bit. It was just the training was the hard bit, you know.
What's your opinion on sparring? Because a lot of people in terms of MMA, when they talk about it, a lot of fighters are slowly cutting it out.
Yeah.
They'll spar a little bit leading into the fight, but not as much as a lot of fighters once did. They say it's usually the sparring that's most taxing.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, 100%. I think with the MMA sparring, well, it just depends what you're doing with the boxing sparring, MMA sparring, kickboxing sparring. I think it's you keep it to a minimal. I think the best thing for any kind of training is short and sharp. You know, on the contact sport, you know, instead of doing 10 rounds of hard sparring, you're better off doing 5 rounds of hard sparring, you know, and maybe doing some other, you know, some other agility stuff or any other sort of going to train, because eventually you do wear the body down and then you get tired, and then when you don't think, and then if you get hit, you know, it's definitely put your body through a threshold, but not to an extent where, you know, okay, one more round, and the guy can't even see where he's going or stuff like that. So the old, you know, the old sort of days of, you know, being up to be the, you know, getting beaten up to be the tough is probably not the best, you know, and it's not longevity. So now you see, you know, with all the reports that you have with sort of like brain damage and stuff like that, then I think it's just now just being smart with your training, you know. You don't have to be, because sparring really is about, you know, it's not, you're either tough or you're not tough.
Yeah.
You know, it's definitely to be conditioned is another thing. Like when you first spar, it's like, ouch, you know, and then the second day, you know, not so much, and the third day, fourth day, then it's fine, something like that. But, you know, or throughout your, you know, throughout your training, it might be a week or whatever, but you get conditioned to it. But to sort of like get sort of like over conditioned, you know, that's a lot of injuries and a lot of losses or bad training is being overtrained.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of guys can go into a fight where they're already sapped with energy, you know, or concussed, you know. It's been so many, you know, you wouldn't know just how many fighters have probably fought either being concussed or overtrained so I think it's managing all that. You know, having someone that can manage that and help you out, diet, everything like that, and then fight smart. You know, so it's not about you know, trying to toughen someone up. You know, it's either they're either going to be a fighter or not a fighter. You know, you're not in between to get to the top. So I think it's important to just sort of really, you know, evaluate every sort of movement, every sort of training pattern that you have there, you know. So like if you see that you're, you know, the student or the fighter has had too much sparring, or you know, he's always been hurt, it's almost sense having another round or something, sit back and recover and get back.
The sports science has definitely evolved a lot with the sports as well. You see, I'm sure probably in the days that you were growing up, probably things like recovery wasn't that big of a thing. Am I right to assume that?
Yeah.
Did you guys do like ice baths or just even
yoga? Not really. I mean,
it was just a day off. A day off is pretty much recovery.
Yeah. So
Nutrition itself wasn't probably as...
Yeah, no, you'd cut weight before you fought, you know, to make weight, you know, but like it was a lot to do with sort of, you know, saunering or, you know, just cutting out food completely. But now, you know, water loading and learning different, you know, tactics of or your carbs, when to eat them, you know.
As a coach, do you have a recommendation for your athletes of best way to cut weight? Generally just lowering the body fat percentage, but I mean
just watch what you eat, you know, and it's good to have, you know, if you're a professional fighter or an amateur fighter on, you know, going to a professional level or, you know, in an international state level as a amateur fighter, it's good to have some of the, because we're all built differently. Yeah. You know, we all run on, you know, sort of, you know, different foods and whatnot, you know, some might be vegetarian, paleo, whatnot. So it's good to have your own sort of, and you want to enjoy life as well. So you don't want to just, you know, eat something that you can't eat. You just probably have a good dietitian.
Yeah.
You know, again, it's all about having, you know, good people on your team, you know, and you have your own individual, you know, segments on things like food, fitness, training, you know, recovery.
Mm.
So, but now there's so many more things out there now, you know, and I think, and you can see that in the progression of MMA or the boxing. Like you see the athletes in the boxing and the Olympics in MMA, like you see the physiques on them compared to the physiques that was 15, 20 years ago on boxers as well. You know? Yeah. So, you know, it's, yeah.
How'd your weight cut go with Japan? Fairly comfortable?
Yeah, it wasn't.
Wait a second. I think I saw a photo of you stripped down. So you must have barely just made it.
Yeah, so I weighed in a little bit over.
A little bit over.
Yeah, it wasn't so much the weight. It was more the timing. We just started a little bit late.
Okay.
I think the guys that were helping me out, they use the sauna a lot more than I do. So their timing, they imagine how long it would take was a bit different to what
you were doing a sauna
cut? Yeah, did sauna. Yeah. So we kind of just went in. They were like, nah, like we're there, and I was ready to go. And then they said, nah, let's just hang around for another hour before we start. You don't want to deplete yourself too early, which is definitely the right thing to do. But I would rather sort of just be safe and get there on time. But still probably holding a tiny bit of water from the plane and stuff like that maybe made it a little bit harder, but it wasn't by any means that, like, it wasn't too bad. It's just the timing.
Let's recap Japan, Jack's trip. How overall, good, great trip. It looked like amazing fun looking at photos and stuff like that. It looked like everyone had an absolute blast.
It was fun. It was awesome. It was great.
Any stories you guys would like to share?
It was just good. It was a lot of banter between everyone. It was fun. It was really exciting. And it was really good to see, you know, we have 11 or 12 people coming to support Jack. It was great, you know. And it's a big thing. You know, it's like, you know, going to a different country, you know.
That must be really pleasing for you as a coach of the gym owner as well, to see a lot of guys to come out to support a fighter, you know, to have that unity of a team is something you must really pride yourself on, you know?
I really tried, you know, of course, you know, Jack has his little entourage and stuff like that. All the fighters have their little entourage, but it's really important to have people, you know, come and support, you know, like in even the little jiu-jitsu competitions or the basic amateur fights and that, because it's like, you know, as when you're there and, you know, maybe you're in a bad situation or your times are tough or, you know, getting beaten up, whatever, and then you've got like a whole bunch of people in the corner screaming out and helping you out, sometimes it can lift your spirits up, you know.
Just that little bit that you need, yeah.
You know, so it's good, you know, it's, you know, to have it sort of everyone in there just cheering for you and helping you out. So it's been good. It was good. A lot of, you know, it was a lot of banter. It was fun.
I had, who was it that tackled the security guard or?
I was in bed as well.
You were in bed as well, so.
I had nothing to do with that.
I might know a name. I might not want to drop it, but we'll see if.
Milo got a bit crazy, but he's a funny dude, eh? Like, especially like getting to go around, like spend that much time with guys that you wouldn't normally hang around with for like every day for 2 weeks.
You get to know them.
You get to know them a lot better. Yeah. So,
Him and Danny just keep going at it, I heard.
Oh,
brothers.
Heaps of arguing, but it's funny as for us.
Yeah. Being neutral.
Yeah.
But coming back to Jack's weight cut and that, when you're sort of like in your own home country or your hometown, wherever you are, you sort of know, you have your foods, you know, you sort of have your routine.
Miles easier.
When you go to a different country, I mean, the food in Japan's a lot starchier, so a lot more noodles, a lot more carbs. Yeah. So it's really hard. And then again, their saunas are different to our saunas, and it's so.
Well, there's so many new elements you don't know. It's mentally taxing as well, in the sense 100%. Of you're continuously thinking, "Am I going to make it? Am I going to make it?" That'd be more more frustrating,
and,
you know.
And more so, Jack knows how to cut his weight, but then it's sort of like being with the Alive camp helped us out heaps. So went with them because they helped him cut weight. So I sort of did their way, but it might not be his way, you know. So it makes it a bit hard, especially mentally as well, when you sort of think, well, I could do this if you let me stay here a bit longer or whatever, you know. But it's all learning. It's, you know, he did make the weight.
It was just like mixing the two, definitely. Because what I would normally do is cut the food down, and then they sort of were like, eat a little bit more, and I'm just not used to it. And I knew it was going to bring my weight back up, but I was just, I did want to sort of move around a bit more. So I was eating a little bit more, but so the way that they do it is that they go to the sauna heaps. Like normally for me, mentally,
like leading into it,
I would just be like, I'm not going to go to the sauna for however long. I never go to the sauna because I don't enjoy it, because it brings back memories of sitting in there when it sucks.
Yeah.
So they're like, oh, we'll get you to go in the sauna today. And I was like, but I'm going to be doing that in a couple of days for a long time. Why would I want to be doing it now? And they're like, yeah, we're going to go again. And it makes sense, but I felt like my metabolism sort of switching, because by the end of the week, I'd sit in the sauna and I'd be pouring sweat a lot faster than I did the first time. But it wore me out a bit. Like after a few days of doing it, like I could tell it made a difference, but it was, I hated it. Like I still didn't enjoy the sauna. But then on the day it went, it was working. It was going quickly, but still not as fast as it would work for them. Because I sat in the sauna with Kume, one of their fighters, and he was pouring sweat. He lost probably more weight than I did.
He's a bigger guy though, isn't he?
Well, he fights at the same weight as I do, and he fought a week or two before I got there, and he did the whole weight cut with me. So he just sat in there just chilling, wasn't even uncomfortable, pouring sweat. And then eventually towards the end, Hatsu was helping me, and he just went out and relaxed for a little bit.
How'd you feel actually on the day, fighting and everything?
Good. I felt 100%.
Yeah.
Especially for 3:15, like for 3:5s, I've always been a little bit anxious about doing the full thing, seeing how I'd feel after 3:5s. I felt fine. I was tired at the end, but that means
I. But you won. You won. Like when I watched the footage, you won every round comfortably.
It's good to get those rounds in.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was happy to.
It's better to have those rounds. Really, 100%. I mean, to have a 10-second knockout's great, but in terms of evolving as a martial artist and being in those situations, sometimes having those dog wars 100%. Are so much more beneficial in terms of long term career, to look back and be like, I've done this before.
Yeah,
you know,
because it is, when he has another fight down the track and it's the second round and he's tough and he's sort of like, you know, going through the motions, it's good to know back, well, hang on, I've done three before. It's not like, it's not the unknown, you know, it's the unknown that's a bit like, what, you know. But if you've been there, done that before, then it's a bit like, oh, well, I've been there, that's all right. Yeah. It's just, you know, another day in the office.
That's actually, if I don't know if you guys saw the last UFC with Dan Henderson and Bisping. That was actually, you could see just the experience of Dan Henderson got him through. It's crazy to think about a guy his age, 46, I think he is. Five-minute rounds, 25 minutes. This is insane. But he was so smart in terms of when he used his burst of his energy. And he lasted the whole round. And, just lost it 3-2, but the experience is always so beneficial. A lot of people don't give the experience as much credit as it deserves, you know.
Oh, because you, like, again, it's all like muscle memory to you. You know, you've been there, you've done that, you know how to pace yourself. I mean, he's been in some big fights over the years, you know, from Pride. I mean, when the first Pride fights, they used to be 10-minute rounds, the first rounds.
Yeah.
And then it'd be 5-5 after that. So.
Do you have a preference in terms of what you see? Because I mean, I'm a believer of the UFC is not really beneficial to grapplers, in terms of 3 5-minute rounds is for the most part, unless it's a championship fight. If you get stuck in a bad position on the ground, if a guy's taking your back or whatever the deal is, if he's turtling, if he's got a minute to go, he's just going to hold that position and just you know, avoid the submission, whatever. Whereas, you know, and the second round starts, you restart standing, you know. I think Troy, actually, from the gym, when I was talking to him, he had a really good idea of you should actually go back to the position that the round ended. So if the guy's got your back, you start again taking your back. I mean, what do you think about that?
I think that'd turn a lot of people off the sport.
You reckon?
People like that reset because a lot of, if you don't understand that all the ground stuff, which is half the world, you want to see people standing.
But I mean,
if a grappler is fighting a stand-up fighter and the grappler's taking the stand-up fighter down and he's not going to let the stand-up fighter stand up, then when the round finishes, the fighter has,
a chance,
50-50 chance again, So,
but do you think it's not really fair in the sense of to emulate a real fight of two guys going at it one-on-one? You shouldn't really have the advantages. Well, you should try to eliminate as much of an advantage.
For me, I think it's a sport. MMA is a sport. They have regulations and rules. Boxing, you have gloves. Kickboxing, you have gloves. You can kick. You can knee. So I think you need regulations and rules. And so as a fight, I think more so as a sport, it has to have, I think the rounds are good, 3-5 minute rounds. If they're any longer, people can sort of, it gets boring.
What would you say, like just the 1 15-minute fight or a 1 25-minute fight? No. Would you not?
No. Even in grappling, it gets to a stage where it's like, you got the ADCC, which I like, but the first, it's a 10-minute fight. There's no points for the first 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's changed. I think it's still the same. So people would do nothing. They collar tie each other for 5 minutes. And then after that, they start attacking and getting the points. So that's more, so I think you want to see excitement. So I think it's, 3 fives are fine. Five fives for titles are good. 3 threes for amateurs are good. I think it's all relevant to everything.
Because some of these fights they used to have as well with no real time limit, some of them went for an hour over.
A 25-minute heavyweight fight would be very boring if no one got knocked out. Imagine the last minute of that, they'd just be sitting there. Yeah. I've seen 15-minute fights where they look like they've been fighting for days. They're just exhausted.
Yeah. But it's just to, kind of answer the question of... it's not even a question. It's just the advantage as much of the certain grappling type or a stand-up type and...
See, so 5 minutes can even be sometimes too long when there's nothing really happening. You know what I mean? So if you imagine if there's tacked on another 5 minutes to that, be like, you could actually go away, come back and watch it, So I think that's probably for the viewer, but then for when, if you're in the bad situation and it's a 3 minute round, then you want to get out of it, it's like, and you need some more, you need a couple more minutes. So
you got to give the general public as well, I guess.
Yeah. Well, it's all about, right? It's all about
viewers and stuff like that. The fans.
If no one was watching UFC,
because
it was too boring or whatnot, then it would sort of slowly die down.
I'm sure you got tons of stories of street fights or guys at the gym or gym wars or. I mean, even that when Linda was your wife was actually sending me photos. I'm going to put them up while we're talking, and she just kept sending me paragraphs and paragraphs of like, you got to talk about this, you got to talk about that, and there's incidences galore with you growing up. Is there a favorite one of yours? I've got a few on the top of my head. I'll bring up, but do you have a favorite
story
that you'd like to share? A gym story or a
No,
the plane incident's always a classic.
The plane, plane. That was quite interesting.
Do you want to share for people what happened with that one?
We're going to Bali. I can't remember when it was.
But she said you guys were coming from America. Actually, was that right?
No. This was
maybe there was another plane incident.
This was in Bali.
Yeah,
and we're going to Bali, and there was a guy from Sydney that was on the Sydney flight to Bali, and then Bali he was going to go to Amsterdam. And he must have been drinking all the way through. So it was on Garuda. And it was like 8 o'clock in the morning. So I've got on the plane and I've started to fall asleep. I thought, great, it's like, I don't have to worry about getting, training and just have fun and a bit of surfing and cool. And then about half an hour later, Linda was waking me up and said, Habby. I said, what? She said, can you help him? I said, help what? She says, oh, no, I'm still asleep. She says, there's a guy going crazy here. And I said, where? So then I turn around, this guy's screaming, like, you know, he was actually knocking on the cockpit door and saying, come in, or, you know, he's wanting to blow things up. And, you know, and this was just after 9/11. So then he was, you know, it was, you know, I thought, oh, well, why, you know, he's all right. He's
post 9/11 is like the last thing you'd want.
And then,
he was white Caucasian guy?
Yeah. Just probably your words. And like, and then he's going, so like,
one of my people would be a different story. People would be freaking out.
So then I said, oh, well, okay. So the steward came past. I said, oh, if you need a hand, I can help, you know, I could probably help you out. And he said, oh, okay, thank you. I'll let you know. So then he come back about 20 seconds later, says, can you help me? And I'm going, okay. So I went up to the guy. I said, mate, can you just be quiet, be nice, because you're scaring all the kids. There was a little kid at the back, and, you know, it's just all families and, you know, old people. And he said, oh, you know, he told me, you know, I don't swear, but he sort of, you know, he told me where to go and like this, and he's, you know, beat me up and whatever. And I said, oh, whatever.
Big build, this guy, or he's just had too much to drink?
It's probably my size, but probably, you know, it's probably in a drinking mood or whatnot, you know. So I sort of just smacked his shoulders and spun him around and choked him and put him to sleep.
Rear naked?
Yeah. And then he's asleep on the floor, and I'm going, well, where do I put him?
overhead luggage.
And they look at me, because it's never really happened before, and they're going, well, take him this way. So just towards the cockpit, right? Yeah. So I've dragged him to the cockpit. He's waking up.
Is anyone else helping you, by the way?
No. So I've dragged him to the cockpit, and they go through first class, because when first class, and they put the curtains through there.
You're just carrying a body with you.
Yeah, they're all looking at me like, what's happened? And they said, and then the other girl goes, no, you can't have him here. He's got to go to the back. So I've twisted him around. By then he's up, you know, he's up, he stopped gagging on that. And so I've sort of like just said, shut up. Gave him a couple of little quiet taps, and then bang, all the way to the back. And this is probably, you know, a good 30 seconds. So then, I said, man, you sit right there. I put him in the corner there. And I said, can you stay with him? So I had to stay with him, you know. And then he was urinating on the seats and headbutting and stuff like that. And
what?
You know, there's a couple of things I felt like doing, but I thought, like, it's not going to really help me. I'm on holiday, by the way.
So he was still going. He after getting choked out, he was still going berserk.
Well, but just to himself, you know. It's probably like the total, you know, like, you know, if he was meant to do something, we probably wouldn't even known, you know.
Yeah.
So So then they landed, and then the police come, took him away, and that was it. And so I thought, that's right. No, actually, they gave me a pair of handcuffs to put on him.
Yeah.
So I put some handcuffs on him. But they snap, they break. So I don't know where they're from, like, you know, like Priceline or whatever.
Gorilla, so you got to up your handcuff.
So, yeah, this is funny. So then, the police took him away. Didn't think anything of it. And then a couple of days down the beach.
I could just imagine your face.
A couple of people go, oh, thank you so much. That was awesome. And I think, like, you know, like, what? And then it's just sort of, because I've worked the doors before too. So it was just like, another day, you know, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, it, you know, just because it was on a plane, it was different, you know.
Especially post 9/11, people would have been freaking
out.
Yeah,
well, yeah, I'll tell you something after that. Anyway, then started getting phone calls, and, you know, it was the West Australian, and the federal police, they're ringing up and saying, oh, you know, what happened? We need to, you know, catch up and have a, you know, I'm thinking, I'm just on holiday, mate. I just want to go for a surf. I just want to relax. And a lot of people come up to me, and then, I come home, and then Garuda gave me some free air business class tickets again. And
nice.
You know, so as long as I didn't say anything on air.
Well, this was, and then, what, 15 years ago?
Yeah, so that happened. But then I think the middle of that year, I went to the States with John Donahue and a team, because we were, competing in Brazil. So we went through the States and trained with Rico Cipriani and Frank Trigg and all them. and they had a big MMA fight night there, and they got me up. There was about 2,000 people there, and they said, "Oh, you know, this guy saved a plane," and you know, you got a standing ovation. It was full on,
really,
because you know? Americans are so patriotic and stuff like that. And that's just happened with the 9/11.
Yeah.
Man, I felt like you know, like a king, so, and they're like, you know, people coming up and hugging me, and I'm going like, "I should do this more often." But it was, yeah, it was cool. You know, I didn't really think much of it, but it, you know, it was just the fact of I was there, and I sort of diffused the situation. It could, you know, really, it wasn't. You know, if it was a terrorist, probably wouldn't have known about it at the start, and who would have been well prepared, he would have just been drunk.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was one of my stories.
Sorry, it's a good one though.
Yeah, on my holiday as well.
You did you say, was it you they said? You saw him a few days after, just walking around?
Yeah, I seen him a few days after. I don't know if he couldn't get a... They wouldn't connect his flight, so he might have had to get another flight or something like that. So
he was just walking around.
Yeah, but I didn't say anything.
Yeah, how's your day been? Yeah. In terms of also, I mean, were street fights quite big growing up for you?
In terms of not really. I worked on the door a lot, and there's a lot, you know.
Because you used to be a head bouncer for a lot of clubs,
yeah,
I heard.
No, a couple of clubs. Yeah, I did some security. I started security when I was 16. You know, I had to be 18, but lied about my age. And I did a lot of security for a couple of companies in Perth. And then I moved up to Broome in Darwin when I was 17. And actually Darwin first, and I worked at the Nightcliff Hotel. It used to be the Limbs Hotel. It used to be a cage bar there. And that was pretty, you know, it was a fair bit of...
Eventful.
Very eventful. And then it's even in Perth, like the old Gobbles, we're at the Gobbles, Exit, you know, a few of those. It was some fun, yeah. And then, not fun, and you know, just fun times, you know.
Yeah.
But
it seems like security guards always have the best stories, actually.
And then I went back to Broome, and I was 17 in Broome, and I got a job at the Robert Bay Hotel. And there used to be the outside beer garden. So I went out there one day and they just said, "Oh, you stand there, you stand there, you stand there." And you know, I was freshly, you know, like a black belt from karate and, you know, thought I was good. And, you know, well, yeah, just, you know, could handle myself. And, you know, I had some amateur kickboxing fights before then. So, you know, I thought, oh, I'm all right. And then there was a big fight in the beer garden. So I've gone, that's it. I'm going to break it up. So I ran out there and I'm trying to break up the fight. And I'm looking around. I'm the only person there. All the other security are behind there just watching me. And next minute, I'm just get hailed on. And it's all the locals. It's all the local broom boys, you know. And they're going like, "Who's this white guy coming in there?" So I copped a few stitches in the back of the head. And then I'd come back and I said, like, where are you? You know, why don't you help me out? I said, "No, you don't get out there." And I said, "Well, why don't you tell me?" He said, "Well, you didn't have time to tell you because you rushed too quick, you know." So then 2 weeks later, they gave me head security.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it was hard because I wasn't even really allowed to sort of be there because I was still 17.
And you're ready to head door.
So, and then I actually, when I turned 18, I started a company called Blitz Security, and I got the name Blitz from the Blitz magazine. And I was teaching karate up there as well, and there was in the Thai boxing, because that's when the Thai boxing started to come in the mid 80s. And then then it just evolved from there. So I did a lot of security work there, and I did some bands, worked with Jimmy Barnes, Paul Kelly, Midnight Oil, and through a couple of guys that used to do security and work for helped me out. So, and then I started doing big security for all the bands that come through and that.
You know? Yeah, I remember you telling me that actually. You did Andre Bocelli, I believe.
I did some personal bodyguard for Andre Bocelli, John McEnroe. A couple of different, you know, like the tennis player.
Yeah.
And not the singer.
Yeah.
I don't know if he was a singer. But just a couple of different. You know, a couple of different gigs. It was good.
Yeah.
And then, so I did security then. And that was a bit of fun.
Had you done a little bit of modeling as well?
Yeah,
I did. Yeah, I've got a few photos.
Oh, really?
Yeah. No. We'll wait till the YouTube comes out.
Yeah. Well,
stunning suits.
Believe me or not, I got a lot of work with Tony Barlow's and Shearer's Menswear, but then I had a few tattoos. And sorry, Mum. And
didn't it go down well?
No, it was all right.
Yeah.
And then really, you know, trying to model and have tattoos was really not on then, you know. Now it's like every model's got tattoos.
Yeah. Know? Yeah, you got tattoos back in the day
when I was 17.
Wow, yeah. You got it that young.
Yeah.
What was the first one you got?
It was Bushido on there. Well, Bushido, Way of the Warrior.
Good enough.
So
how upset was Mum about that one?
Then I was sort of like traveling a bit and at home.
She didn't see it for a while.
Yeah.
So kind of covered it up. It's a good place to
come. I think she cried when she sang it, but that's all right.
It's a weird one, tattoos. It was kind of...
defacing your body.
Yeah, it was. I mean, my father even says you get a tattoo, you get a piercing, I'll skin it off, I'll pull it off, whatever it is. I've never got anything, but... I've always wanted to get something, but...
You can have a couple of mine if you want.
I've
had enough of them.
You ever get them filled in and stuff? Like, just touched up and stuff, or...
No, not really. Nah.
They usually say you have to every few years, but they're still looking good, Nick.
I'm pretty slack with a lot of things, Cina.
Yeah. No, it's good. Anything you guys want to finish up on? Talk about? Jack, you got...
Let's talk about Jack a bit, because I... what's in the pipeline for Jack? Jack's going to America... next month for the Nogi Worlds.
Yeah, on the first, Tuesday the first.
Nice, nice. How long are you going to say? You're going out there with Marco?
Yeah, Marco, Demi and Rod will go on out there. So we'll be there for 7 days.
Yeah.
Which would be cool. Get there a couple of days, just get used to the time difference and then compete. Looking forward to it. And then got like a day or two to hang out after and then come back home. Yeah, nice. So I'm looking forward to it. It should be sweet.
You guys know, you going to train out there while you're there, or just some very light stuff?
We'll do light stuff before, but whenever you finish a comp like that, especially the training,
you just want to carb out, don't you?
Pretty much, you just want to eat.
Especially coming out of an MMA bout, dieting, you got pretty fit for that one and trained hard for it.
Yeah, for sure.
That's pretty much it for the year for you? I mean, we're going on to
November. See how we go. Whatever pops up. But
try and maybe give him another fight by the end of the year. And hopefully we can bring a team over to the Europeans.
Yeah.
There's a big comp on the Europeans.
Oh, really?
But his the comp, the IBJJF Nogi Worlds would be tough. Because they have a lot, like I said, like we were talking about before, there'd be a lot of, you know, boys that have done a lot of wrestling as well. So it'll be
especially
a tough
comp. Nogi, yeah.
Yeah. It's not as big as comp, I think, as a Gi.
Yeah.
But definitely be a hard
Americans, especially if they have that wrestling background, just integrate some submissions. That'd be great on their stand up. So
yeah,
but I'm sure you do well.
Yeah, it's sort of tell from the body types.
He hasn't got a bad shoot either on him. He's really good.
What do you want to do? Like, because the year's almost out. Next year, just get into some more MMA or you want to try just a bit of anything? Then any boxing bouts?
No, yeah, I have. Not lately, though.
Yeah,
he won the amateur...
state title, was it?
No, he won the state titles, didn't you? Novice state titles. Yeah, he won the novice...
No, it was the novice silver gloves.
Silver gloves.
Same thing. Not quite.
Yeah,
that's cool. Amateur boxing was cool. I liked it. I'll do it again. I don't know when exactly, but it was fun. It's different.
Yeah.
Whole different type of training.
It's actually something we were talking about before you came down. And how we were talking about... boxing, MMA, about the future of, you know, combat sports, about what's progressing, what's not. It seems like boxing's time to die out a little bit. You know, you got guys like Triple G, Canelo, we were talking about, and a few guys around, but for the most part, UFC is pretty much, MMA, sorry, it's pretty much taking over. It seems like the future of the combat sports.
Yeah. You know? I think so, because everyone can go to it. In whatever you're doing, you can take that, learn a little bit more, and then join in.
Yeah,
it's not that you couldn't do it the other way around, but.
And I think the amateur boxing is really good because it's basic footwork, you know, and you can get fights every second week, third week, you know, big gloves, headgear. It's, you know, bar the occasional headache you can get, it's really, there's not many injuries.
Yeah,
in that,
that's you know? For sure.
A few years ago, actually, I remember speaking to you about this, about juniors boxing, mm-hmm. how they wanted to actually ban it within, I don't know if it was WO Australia itself. I remember you saying, up to a certain age, actually, kids shouldn't be really boxing.
Yeah, I don't think kids should be getting hit in the head.
At too young with the brain development.
I mean, I've seen kids do MMA in Russia and stuff like that, you know. It's crazy. It's ridiculous.
Too young,
I think a full contact sports, I think you should be 18 at least, you know.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, probably for as a professional, you know, and I think you have to be 18 or 19 to be a professional fight. But amateur boxing, So adolescent years, maybe 14, 15, 16 years old.
Yeah.
We at the gym, I mean, there's a lot of gyms that teach boxing for kids and Thai boxing and that. But I certainly believe more so on the basic of judo and jiu-jitsu for young kids. And then when they're older, you know, when they're 15, 16, they want to box and fight. But yeah, I don't think kids really should, you know, box.
The head trauma, yeah.
But then again, like in different countries like America and Russia, a lot of the, you know, the world champions have started when they're 10 years old,
yeah.
8 years old, you know, but it's a different way of life.
You see, I mean, your brain's obviously functioning and you know, speech impairment and stuff like that. You do see guys with boxing, though, in their later years. Do you think it's a matter of luck or just how they train? Maybe their weight cuts? The taking the brain damage, unfortunately, in the combat sports is sometimes an issue, yeah. You know?
But it just depends on how many fights you had. I mean, yeah. I had a dozen kickboxing in a boxing fight and one MMA fight. So it was like, you know, those guys have had hundreds of fights and stuff like that. So and it just depends. And again, on the coach, you know, like if they should be sparring when they're tired or, you know, they've been concussed or something, that's different, you know, or fighting someone they shouldn't be fighting. So it's all management as well, you know?
Yeah.
But, and again, we're all different, you know, and it's all timing.
Yeah.
It's all timing, you know, like you could be the best in the world at a certain time, but then let's say if you're a boxer and you're a heavyweight fighter and it was in the era of Tyson, that would have been a tough, you know, that sort of, you know, would have been a tough one.
Is he your favorite boxer?
No, I don't think I have a favorite boxer.
No.
I think they're all, you know.
Did you have a favorite martial artist growing up?
I liked Jackie Chan because it was funny. You know, yeah. I really, you know.
You've been in a movie with him.
Yeah,
one movie?
I lived in Hong Kong for a couple of years in 92 to 94. And after I left Broome. And I went up there.
Took you out there?
Because I talked to Richard Norton and we're talking about movies because Richard Norton was with his Indian Karate days and he was doing jiu-jitsu as well. And he was based in the States, but he was going backwards and forwards. And I said, I'm going to go to Hong Kong and give it a go. So I went over there and I was there for a week. And I met a guy called Bobby Samuels, American guy, and he was on a movie called Don't Give a Damn. He said, like, you know, if you want to come down and sort of like have a look. So I come down and I went onto the movie set and I met Samuel Hung. And Samuel Hung was, remember the old Jackie Chan movies used to be Jackie Chan, the big fat guy, mm-hmm. Samuel Hung, and Yuen Biu. So there'd be three of them. Like, and they were from the Chinese opera, you know, the old sort of like Shaolin days and stuff like that. So he says, oh yeah, good. And he said, show me something. So I said, okay. So just in the booth, so I took my shirt off, did a couple of kicks, like just shadow sparring. And he said, thank you, bye. And then left. And then I thought, oh, that's wicked. That sucked.
Yeah.
And then a week later, I got offered a job and it was just, I was getting $300.
From that guy?
Yeah, from I think 350 Hong Kong dollars or $1,000. I can't remember what it was. It was, you know, it was a couple hundred bucks, $300, $400 a day. And then I worked for a week and then I ended up for a month. And then I did a couple other movies there. And then...
Is that where the whole movie progression kind of started?
Yeah, all from there.
And you never planned for it to kind of just...
Not at all, you know. Just thought it was a bit of fun, you know. Mm. And then I did a few movies. I actually did 6 movies in Hong Kong. And then I flew to Thailand because I did Van Damme did the casting in Hong Kong for at Planet Hollywood for the Quest.
Yeah.
So I got that and then went back to Perth, did the Quest. And then a couple of years later, I got a phone call from Samuel Hung saying, doing a movie in Melbourne with Jackie Chan. And that was after Jackie Chan did Rumble in the Bronx.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah, awesome.
Oh, that was a good movie. Yeah. I remember that one.
That was the next movie after. So that took 3-4 months in Melbourne to do. And Hunter Valley in Queensland, in New South Wales.
Yeah.
It was fun. It was good. He was really, good to work with. It was fun. And then I come back, and then that was it. Then I started getting more into teaching and opening up the gym in the late 1997.
Yeah. I've actually got the clip from The Quest where you're fighting Van Damme. You seen it lately, Jack?
I saw it the other day.
Someone put it on.
This is for me, because when I first walked into the gym, I kept looking at you going, I know this guy from somewhere. Where do I know this guy from? And finally, I just looked to my left and your photo's there with Van Damme. And I was like, that's it. He's a German fighter, I remember.
German fighter with Japanese tattoos.
I'll play the video.
Have we got any photos of Jack today? I've got a couple of good ones.
Jack, yeah.
That was James Reimer. He didn't like us very much on the set because we kept stealing his private taxi.
Really?
Yeah, he had a private driver. So, can we use you?
Where was this filmed?
This was actually filmed in Mae Hong Song.
Okay.
Near the Burmese border.
I'm looking mean, Habby. Look at that.
Yeah, that's just makeup. I'm actually. That was Roger Moore. That was good.
Everyone's super friendly on set. No real egos.
The guy who did the stunt coordinator was really bad. He was actually, remember John Wood? He's a actor.
Sounds very familiar. Yeah. Familiar.
It was his stunt coordinator. And we all had a chance to do our own choreography.
Yeah.
And he was getting me to do like spinning jump kicks back. And I said, no, that's not me, I just fight the way I fight. And then they're actually going to sack me because I was being hit by. So, mate, you got me here for what I do. I can't do something like you don't want me to do, you know? And it won't look right.
Yeah.
So, I bet she got my way. He got the sack.
Oh, really?
So, we actually did the choreography with his body double.
Yeah.
And then he'd come in and look at it and go, oh, I want to do this and do that.
Yeah.
So,
I love this movie. I can't tell you how many times I've seen
it. That's a sumo fighter. That's yeah, that is. In the MMA.
Yeah.
I love that triple rip to the body.
Yeah. Well, shall I use my air pull through?
The Spanx, the pull was your signature move. Because that was the thing about it in this movie. Everyone had their little signature moves. The Spanish guy did his little...
Now, this bit here, it's in Van Damme's all fights. He'll make me look at my shoe. So you watch him. He looks at my shoe. I look at my shoe. See? Yes? Then gets me. So I've never done that before in a fight. Not anymore.
Jack, you want to try that?
And look at the foot.
Yeah. Look at the fight.
But you watch Van Damme's fights, he does it all the time.
And how's this for you to get armbarred by Van Damme?
I used to show it to him about 20 minutes beforehand.
I was going to say, that must have been your idea, surely, to actually pull off the armbar.
That whole fight scene is probably 2.5 minutes, took like 4.5 days.
Wow.
Yeah.
How did it take for...
Just cutting and
just going backwards and forwards and...
Yeah, just cutting it and coming back.
How long did the whole movie take then?
Probably 4 months.
Okay.
4 and a bit months. So for an hour and a half movie, 4 months.
Yeah.
Yeah, so... Yeah, but they have 4 days doing different things. And then, of course, they have different... You have camera A, camera B. So if they were filming here, other actors would be filming somewhere else as well. So you'd be filming... Not everyone's just at the one place. Like you got two different camera crews. Like sometimes when you watch the credits, you see camera crew A, B, and then so there was three camera crews there. So when we'll be doing that. They might be doing something else over there, something over there. But it's good. We got to travel a fair bit in time. We did like Mae Hong Song, Yu Him. Mae Hong Song was cool because they had all the people with the long neck.
And yeah.
All the rings
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
And then, Phuket, we were there. Chiang Mai. Yeah, it was some good places. Bangkok. So there was, it was good. And I met heaps of good people in there. A good friend of mine that I still keep in contact now is an ex-Navy SEAL.
Yeah.
And he was Van Damme's stunt double. Nice. And, awesome guy, you know, great. A lot of them, a few of the actors are pretty, so Roger Moore was awesome. Yeah. He was great. He was really fun.
Do you talk to any of them still?
No.
No.
I talked to a couple of the...
It's going
to
say I'd love to give Van Damme a call right now.
The guy, Cesar Carneiro, he's the Brazilian guy who does the capoeira there. Yeah. I still talk to him. He has a big gym in... an MMA gym. He's a lot of MMA fighters. Really? They fight in the UFC and in Bellator. And really? It's called MMA Masters in Miami.
Oh, nice.
So he's the striking coach there.
He's good capoeira. I remember
watching it. Yeah, it was awesome, yeah. He done a couple of movies, even Only the Strong.
Yeah.
That was good.
Nice. Anything else you guys want to finish up on before we do plugs? And we've done a good hour and 10 so far.
I don't know. No. I'm not sure.
Anything you want to say, Habby, before we finish good. Up?
Thanks a lot for having us over here.
Oh, man, anytime.
Sorry that I've sort of overtaken Jack.
It's all right. It's my third time.
Jack's been on a few times, actually. He'll probably continuously be on.
And we made a couple bucks in the swear jar.
Well, you made $4. Only two times I slipped up. With social media, you're actually pretty good with your social media. You're pretty good. I enjoy your posts here and there.
Yeah, I'm learning. I'm very.
I just got to get you on Snapchat.
You're on
Snapchat.
Yeah,
you got it.
But I've lost it. I lost the. I don't know. I lose a lot of things on my phone. But yeah, I'm enjoying the Instagram because it's a bit better than Facebook. I don't like Facebook too much.
Well, there's a lot of, with Facebook, there's a lot of this
trash.
I get to hear a lot of people's stories, and sometimes you still want to hear
statuses and stuff like that, and it gets all a little bit lost with articles and stuff like that being posted. But Instagram, if you enjoy that, your Instagram is MF1. No, it's
MF1.
No, sorry, M1.
M1FC.
M1FC.
My Instagram is Mac1 Fight Club.
Yeah, I'll put the link as I normally do. As you're saying this, Jack, yours is always just heating up. You're just blowing up on this.
3,000 followers yesterday.
Damn.
Picking up.
It's always hot right now. Jack's doing well. You want to repeat it for the cameras as well? Your Instagram.
What is it? Jack and Becker.
What's your Snapchat have? So I got to get you on Snapchat.
I don't know.
It's M1FC.
It's
M1FC.
All right. I got to add you. Add Jackie as well. I've got Jackie already, but I'm at Project C, as majority of people know by now. And just thank you guys for coming on.
Thank you.
Definitely very fulfilling having you on here. I'm definitely going to have you on in the future as well. Jiu-jitsu and training is definitely part of your life, but there's a lot of other things, elements to you that are quite interesting to me that I want to talk to you about in the future. Spirituality, yoga, and stuff like that.
Yeah,
quite an interesting journey you've had
through your life. You should do one with Linda.
Yeah. I'll definitely. That's actually one I plan to do. Yeah, because you guys, for people that don't know, Habby's a. Well, how does the yoga?
So many good.
How does it work? Are you guys are you a yoga master? How does it work? Like your branding, you get certificates.
I'm still a student. I'm still a student. In everything. I'm a qualified yoga instructor as of last year.
Yeah.
And my wife was a year before. So, but I'm still learning. Still learning. So I don't really class myself as a yoga teacher. More of a student. I'm enjoying it. I can teach to a certain point, and I'm always learning. And that's the beauty of it.
Yeah, beautiful. We'll end it on that note. Thank you guys for coming on once again. Thank you everyone for watching. I appreciate this love and support. Everyone been watching the podcast means a lot to me. And we're out.